Welcome, welcome, welcome to another exciting episode of Diva Speaks Podcast. This is your hostess, Angela, and I want to thank you all for tuning in on this lovely Sunday afternoon for the first recording. And I have my trusty sidekick with me. Say hello to the people, Jazz.
Hey, what's up, y'all? I'm back at it again.
She's back at it again. I want to give a special shout out and thanks to our sound engineer who doesn't want to be a part of the show, which is cool. What's up, Jorge?
Hey.
And I want to let you guys know we have a very special guest that's going to be a part of the podcast today. Bailey, would you like to say hello to the people?
Hi, guys.
Hey, Miss Bailey. Yes, she is one of our beautiful, shining, educated millennials who we are going to have a candid conversation with today regarding what is the show's topic, Jasmine? Or have I even told you what it's about? Today we're going to be discussing breakups and heartbreak. Letting go.
It's so hard.
Right? How to let go of a person and or a relationship when you know this person and the relationship is no good for you and is definitely not good to you. Right, Bailey? Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
All right. So I would also like to take this opportunity to thank the listeners for tuning in to Diva Speaks Podcast. We like to ask you to not only listen, but share, support, and subscribe to Diva Speaks Podcast. I have to differentiate that Diva Speaks is all one word, because if you separate the two, you may not get Angela the hostess. So, Miss Jasmine, I want to talk to Bailey today about a very sensitive subject about relationships. So I'm just going to ask that you get your tissues out now so you don't interrupt the show. Looking for your tissue.
I'll try my best to hold back my tears.
Please hold back your tears. So, Miss Bailey.
Yes,
we had a pre-discussion a few days ago about your relationship. And I want you to walk me and the listeners through what you have been through so that we can get a millennial's perspective on what you guys, and you specifically, are going through in the dating process, how you're handling your relationships, your issues, and your breakups. So tell us a little bit about you and your story.
Okay, so we were together, met him when I was in school. So basically, I was there in high school for years. We met in school. We were together for 4 years. You know, like how any girl that was as young as me that met somebody that was just like, oh yeah, maybe, you know, you talk, you know, you just want it to be like all of us, maybe just that one person.
Oh girl, well, yes.
That's really what I had. I never really went through like a talking stage with him. It was more so like, oh, you know, him and baby have a thing, and then a bad situation that happened. And then he ended up moving in with me and my mom. And so, like, it wasn't necessarily, like, we had faith when we were growing up into our relationship, because we lived together. And so, I mean, there's a lot of people who had, like, comments about it. There were, like, a lot of people who would question, like, my character. A lot of people that questioned his character, my mom's character.
Okay, so explain what were they questioning?
It's okay, it's not really a big deal. I was just like, where my mom is just his guardian until he's 18, and then he can leave if he wants to.
So, Bailey.
And, yeah.
What were they questioning? Because I can I'm trying to understand, because you said a lot of people were questioning the relationship and aspects of when your parent got involved. What were the issues, or what did people take issue with that made them have questions?
They were just asking. It was just that, people were saying that in order for him to move in, that obviously that I was pregnant, and that y'all, like, it was just a whole bunch of rumors, and like people were like, "Oh, obviously she's pregnant, because that's the only reason why he would move in, or that's the only reason why, like, her mom would let, you know, him move in." And like people were just like, "What type of mother allows their daughter to have their guy move in with them?" And like I had to explain it to like all these friends, like three people. I was just like, "I'm not pregnant. I'm not none of that. It's just he had a mishap with his parent, and his parent wasn't, you know, allowed to be his guardian anymore, legalized until he was 18, and so they gave it to my mom." And so it did create some type of conflict with some people, because I did end up getting bullied about it. They were just like, "Oh no, there's no hiding, you know, secrets." You know, people would judge me and be like, "Oh, she's, you know, a hoe or something."
Why?
You know, that's a good question. I really don't know why.
Okay, so
I used to ask people that too, like, what's the big deal of having my guy live with me? And they were just like, "It just don't seem right." They said it sounded too perfect. And I would tell them, "Oh, it's hard for perfect. Like, it's difficult."
So Bayla, let me stop you right there just to catch everyone up who's listening. So you were high school sweethearts with a young man. You guys dated for a period of about 4 years, and the relationship really progressed kind of fast. And at some point, this young man had to move into your home. It was a guardianship issue with this young man, correct? Okay, and as a result of that, your peers and other people that you know and love started to have questions and started to judge you based on that particular situation. Okay, so let me just say, that's a lot. That's a lot for a young person to have to deal with, number one. I think that at your age, with me knowing you, I don't think that the level of emotional maturity was there quite yet to handle such a complex situation. But the two of you are not together now, correct?
Yeah, we're not together anymore.
What happened? I mean, you've been through so much. You've been through 4 years of fighting against the world, so to speak, and the rumors and people talking about you and creating stories surrounding what brought you to living together. What happened that the two of you, against all of that, you're not together anymore?
I think it started last year. In like November of last year, we had ended up moving out of my mom's place, and you know, things were good. We moved in a two-bedroom with my sister, and you know, during us being in the two-bedroom, I was obviously different because we had our own space than what we normally did. So, like, it was like, "Oh, I will come home from work, you'll come home from work, and we'll have, like, our own things going on in our head." And then, you know, we just got to the point where we were just like, "Okay, maybe we need to have our own space to, like, settle." But it's like, we have our own spot and not have a two-bedroom with my sister. So, you know, later or earlier in this year, I'm going to say it was like around March. Oh, it was March. It was like March 15th. And me and him had moved into our own apartment. And, you know, things were good. So, like, the first month of us living there, and then, like, you know, just a lot of changes started to happen, like, in attitude ways. There was a lot of questioning going on between both of us, and I had questioned him, like, if he was talking to other people, like, and he questioned me about some of the people that I used to work with, and was like, well, did you know that this person, you know, likes you, but you still hanging out with this person? And, like, me personally, like, I don't get along with females at all. Like, it's always a problem whenever I make a female friend. But a lot of my friends are guy friends. And, you know, I don't understand, like, how it came to become a problem with them, for me having, like, a whole bunch of guy friends. Because, like, even when I was in school, I had nothing but, like, guy friends and, like, probably two female friends. And, you know, he was just like, as he would ask me whenever he's mad, like, are you sleeping with this person? Is that why y'all are friends? He was just like, is everybody that, like, would say things about you, like, is all that stuff true? And, like, the words just kept getting, like, more and more, like, hurtful on both ends. So I was just like, it's funny how, you know, you see that in me, but you look at yourself in the mirror. And, like, it just got crazier.
Okay. So here's what we know so far. You two transition out of the residence that you first established living together, and you went into another residence, and that's when things kind of escalated and spiraled out of control. I can tell you that from listening to your story, I want to reemphasize again, through no fault of your own, it's just a learning experience and a teachable moment that, you know, coming right out of high school and taking on the responsibility of managing a relationship of that magnitude was a bit too much for the both of you. Verbal abuse is usually a good indicator that the two of you shouldn't be together. That leads to facilitating a toxic relationship. And unless you have the proper tools and the wherewithal or counseling or a combination of all of those things, things can only get worse, and it does lead to a breakup, and usually it's not amicable. What do you say about that, Jasmine?
Yeah, I totally agree. At, you know, right out of high school, that's like 17, 18, like, kids just really don't understand, like, how you can really be so involved with someone and, like,
yeah.
You just wake up and they don't feel the same way. And there's nothing that you can, some, you know, at some point do about it. And when you try to force them to stay, when they, you know, they're like, I want something different. I want something new. Or I'm just young and I want to be young and don't want to be attached. That's hurtful.
It is hurtful. And, you know, then you interject the feelings of rejection. Mm-hmm. And like you said, it's through no fault of Bailey's. I mean, knowing her personally, Bailey, for our listeners, she's extremely gorgeous. I mean, one of the most gorgeous females, yes, you'll ever lay your eyes on. And it's kind of unfortunate for you that this happened, because no one that knows you and loves you wants you to ever experience pain of that magnitude. So I would suggest using it as a teachable moment. You know what I'm saying? Because I think when we spoke earlier, you did tell me that your ex had started entertaining making of new friends of the opposite sex, you know, which usually is not a good sign. That's just my personal opinion. When, you know, someone you're committed to is making friends of the opposite sex, and it's not like they're both of you guys' friend. It's just his friend, and you're excluded from that particular friendship. I wouldn't say that's a good thing. There are people out there that can handle that. But being that you guys are so young and you're millennials, that's usually, like Jasmine was talking about, that's age. That's age. That's curiosity. That's immaturity. It has really, yes, not that much to do with you, even though it affects you. And I was telling you about, usually at this age when you're breaking up, you know, having the proper tools to be able to deal with it. You know, I can share with you personally that I think one of the hardest breakups in my entire life, it happened many, many moons ago, but it left me emotionally distraught. I was in a state of disbelief. I felt like my life was in shambles, but I knew that in order to get out of that bad headspace and emotional dark place that I was in, I needed to go seek therapy. And that's exactly what I did. I went to and through 2 weeks of intense therapy on learning how to cope with and deal with those feelings of rejection, learning how to live my life a different way without this person that exited my life unexpectedly. I mean, you go through a whirlwind of emotion, and I guess that's the message I want to communicate to you personally and millennials, that, you know, it's okay to feel that. No, this is what I'm trying to say. It's okay to grieve the relationship. If you're sad about it, it's okay, because that means that you were experiencing real love from your end. And it's okay to not heal within a day. You know what I'm saying? Healing and hurting, they can occupy the same space, but they don't necessarily, you know, resolve at the same time. What are your comments about that, Jasmine? Do you think healing and hurting can occupy the same space?
I totally agree. That's exactly what I did when I had had my like first like real just heart. I was just heartbroken.
Really?
I could.
Because you're known as the heartbreaker.
I know, which is so, you know, I felt there was
right,
a little
Bailey?
Bit of karma coming back. I'm going to be honest. I felt it was a little bit of karma coming back on me. But I was just, oh my goodness, the sky was not blue, The sun did not rise, like, I was just over it. And I left school for a little bit.
Oh, wait a minute, your breakup affected your education.
Oh yeah, I had to take a break from school, I was not right. I just, emotionally, I was just distraught, mentally, I was exhausted. And it took a toll on me. And people have to understand that relationships do take tolls, because this energy and emotions and experiences that you put into somebody, and when it ends, like you said, prematurely, abruptly, you don't even know what happened. Like, one day we was good, the next day we weren't, you not returning phone calls, you know, you dapping me up, and you seem like, what? Whoa.
Right.
And,
you have to it's like a whole different mindset in life now.
Right.
Oh, wow. Say that again. I like that. What was the point that you just made? I like that. Yeah.
You by yourself, but you still have the world that you had before you met that person. But you have to go back into your own world of just yourself. If that makes sense.
It does make a lot of sense, especially since you guys know I'm a fashionista. I love wardrobes, and I love updating my wardrobe. So it's kind of like giving yourself an emotional and lifestyle makeover without the person that you loved. You have to like force yourself, like, okay, you know what? This happened. It's not what I preferred. It's not what I wanted for myself, even if it had to end. Most of the time, we all can agree, it doesn't end the way that we want it to end, correct?
Right, absolutely. Right. I thought we was friends. What happened?
Yeah, I thought we could go back to being friends. We could be cool. But based on, I would say, how you break up basically has an impact on how you get over it and how long. I think the more devastating the breakup and how bad or tacky the breakup is, it really has a relationship as to how long it takes you to get over it. You know what I'm saying? Does anybody in the room know what I'm saying?
Yeah. I feel it 100%.
Like if you broke up with me, you know, with the girl that took my order at Starbucks every morning and I have to see her every day out of the blue, I'm going to feel some type of way. But if we had agreed that, okay, you know what, this isn't working, you're not for me, I'm not for you, then you know what, it's not so hard to get over it. So let me ask you, Bailey, what are your plans for yourself? How do you plan to bounce back from this life lesson? Because that's what we're going to call it. We're going to call it a life lesson.
There's no discussing it or anything, like you're automatically just gonna move back in with me. didn't get to do what, like, I needed to do for myself that I needed, that I thought I needed to get done. Because, you know, I had that, I thought for a while I called him my bulldog, because I'm just like, you're just trying to handle everything for you, so you're my bulldog. And so that's what I called my mom. And literally, I had a conversation with her, which is like, hey, you know, I'm the one going through this, and I'm the one with the emotions going, you know, up and down. And I was just like, I need to just have space to myself and figure out what I want to do.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, that's what I did. Like, I left for, like, almost 2-3 weeks. You know, I just went out of town, just was in my own space, in my own world, just trying to figure out, like, what is it that I want to do? How do I want to get over this? You know, how do I want to handle this? So, like, mind you, I was avoiding him. I was, like, he was, like, need to talk, and I was, like, no, we're good. It's no more her feelings. I don't want to deal with this. And, you know, I ended up talking to one of my uncles, and was just, like, in order for you to physically move on and be okay with, you know, being no longer with him in life, you have to be able to talk to him and hear what he has to say. You know, that's going to help you move on and move forward. And the stubborn person that I am was like, no, I don't want to listen to what he has to say, because all he's going to say is sorry. And it's just going to be the same situation over and over again. And so my uncle was just like, if that's how you feel, then that's how you feel. But eventually you're going to fully understand where I'm coming from when I say what I said. And, you know, it took him a couple of days for him to sink it, and I was just like, you know, very lucky. And he had this conversation with him. Let me hear what he has to say, and then we'll go on from that.
What
he had to say, and I was just like, you know, at the end of the day, you put yourself in this predicament, I was just like, you can't get mad because of the choices that I am making from this day forward. And I told him, I was like, you need to just, like, we'll try to be friends. And I was just like, if it doesn't work out, then we're not meant to be, like, friends. And I tried to be friends with him for, like, all of a month. And, like, I killed it. I was just like, this is not, because, like, he kept popping up. He would ask people, you know, have y'all talked to her? He'll be like, oh, let's go do this, let's go do that. And I'm like, no, I have things of my own that I have to get done. And, like, it even got really more worse whenever, like, one of my friends was just like, you know, he's talking to someone. And, like, he didn't like that. And, like, I came home from work one day, and he was just waiting. And was like, oh, I hear that you're talking to someone, and I was like, this isn't healthy. I was just like, it's no longer a you and I, it's like just an I, and then there's you. I was just like, that music is clicking in your head.
So are you saying?
And, I would say the very mindset is completely different than how it was when everything was first happening, because I was still in that mindset, like, okay.
So, Bailey, let me ask you this. So, what it sounds like you're saying, I get a couple of things from what you're saying that could be actually shared with other people. So you started the healing process by first grieving. That's what you did. You started the grieving process of the relationship that was longer no more. Then you made it mandatory to have your own space. You gave yourself the space needed to be able to process what happened to you abruptly, because you needed to figure things out, like how you were going to move forward with your life as a newly single person. And then you avoided him for a while so that he wouldn't have any emotional triggers, so that you could actually heal in a safe place. And at the advisement of one of your family members, you eventually resumed conversation with your ex to be able to get some type of closure. That's how I'm going to name it. So what I wanted to say to all of that was bravo to you for taking charge of your healing. That is a, what I like to say, a big girl moment. You took charge of your healing and you were unapologetic about it. And I love that. But you know what I find so funny, Bailey and Jazz? I saw a meme on social media that said, isn't it funny that the offender in the relationship or the one that did the most dirt in the relationship or the one that broke it off is usually the one who gets in a relationship the fastest, another relationship? And based on Bailey's story, she said that she had heard in the streets that this young man was already talking to someone else. That is just, to me, that supports my belief that you have to take charge of healing. You have to go ahead and grieve the relationship because whatever you thought you had isn't what it was. Or even if the person loves you, that person is not offering the type of love that is, number one, healthy and that would support your growth, being that you are a millennial or any woman of any particular age or any man of any particular age. I think we have to protect our emotional and mental well-being. You know, you know what I'm saying? Can you speak to that?
Oh, yeah, definitely. It doesn't just, you know, just because, you know, you get to an age where you call yourself grown doesn't mean, you know, you have to put up with certain stuff as well. You know, like, if I'm still growing in my, you know, mental, emotional, spiritual journey, then you got to be able to grow with me.
Right, you know. Yeah. And you know what? And it's okay to ask for help. I want to put that out there. It is okay to ask for help. I'm a big supporter of privacy. And I like for my life and my relationships to be private. I only share what I want people to know. However, there is a certain part of me where life gets to be too much with any type of relationship. It's okay to seek out help, seek the wisdom of an older family member or someone that you can trust with the intimate details of your life. And me knowing you personally, I know that you have a wonderful support system, but I thought it was just so amazing, your story and how incredible and resilient you are, that I wanted to actually get your story out there to be a source of support to other people who could be going through the same thing. Now, with me sharing my story, you know, I'm old enough to be your mom. But, you know, heartbreak can happen at any age. And I don't care what age you are, it doesn't lessen the blow. And I think a lot of people would do themselves justice if they would accept the fact, like I said earlier, that healing doesn't happen in a day. You know, it doesn't happen in a day. And as soon as we could all get that through our heads, I think every day, because everybody says, you know, oh, take it one day at a time. Well, if you're taking it one day at a time, then you understand that today is not the day that the healing is going to be. Mm-hmm. It's not going to happen today. So why not enjoy this day? Why not create opportunities of happiness and healing along the way? You know, creating that scalp over that wound, you know. So I would encourage you moving forward to take it a little bit slower, because you have so much to offer the world, Bailey, in terms of your modeling career, your education. You're beautiful, you're bright, you're articulant, and most definitely your wife material. So as we wrap up the podcast, are there any questions that you would like to ask the hostess and my sidekick?
Oh, I know this is bad, but then they just really can't handle those days when it is bad.
what advice would I give to someone that's going through the grieving stage? I want to make sure I understand the question correctly. Okay. I would pose the question because I participate in a handful of groups, women groups, that focus on women's issues in relationships. And the advice that I give is posed in a question. What do you love more? Which do you want more? Do you want him in that relationship, or do you want to be happy? And do you want to have an opportunity to meet someone who will treat you better? I think that is the first step to getting over someone, because you do have to make that choice. You have to decide, okay, do I want him, or do I want, if you're a religious person, do I want what God has for me? Do I want the pain and the issues and the baggage that comes with this toxic relationship who makes me question myself, a relationship that speaks to my insecurities, a relationship that stunts my growth as far as every area of my life is concerned? Or do I want to exit now, experience the pain, come out of it a better person, a bigger person with resources and tools to transition into the next relationship? It's all about finding out what you want the most. Now, if you want that person more than you do your own happiness, I say to that person, seek counseling, because you don't know your worth. You don't know your worth, and you don't know what true happiness is, because happiness is not about depression. Happiness is not about settling for someone mistreating you because you think that the pain that you're going to bear when they leave is so intense you can't bear it. Happiness is not about being happy all the time either. You know, it's not about being happy all the time. I would say when you come out of this process, because it's like a storm, you're going to come through it. It is not going to last. Nothing lasts forever, not even life. So when you come out of it, when you move forward in your next relationship, you know, choose a person who is going to commit to the idea, bare minimum, of whether I like you today or not, I'm choosing to be committed to you. Whether I like you today or not, I'm going to make decisions that will not negatively impact our relationship and our lives. Whether I like you or not today, I'm still going to do my best to try to make you happy as far as that is concerned. And I'm committed to staying in love with you as long as we decide to take this journey together. Those are the type of grown-up decisions that we all have to ask ourselves when we are in these relationships. You know, the person that you're choosing to give your heart to, because love just don't happen like that unless you're having a baby. Some people are mammies. It don't happen for them either. But, you know, you're making a choice to be in a relationship with this person and be around them on a consistent basis, or at least bare minimum enough to being around the person enough to establish feelings. You got to take control of that and say, you know what? Let me stop this before this goes any further. Pay attention to the red flags, or understand that I'm looking at these red flags. I'm choosing to ignore them, but am I willing to pay the price of the heartbreak that's going to come with this? Because it's coming whether I want to accept it or not. Is the ride to hell worth it? That's the advice I would give you. Oh, girl, I know. Please.
And so, I just feel like a lot of people are really blindsided by, like, what the actual real meaning of love is. Because, you know, that person could be like, I love you.
Or do you know that a person could, well, they could actually love you, but not love you in the manner that you can receive it. Just because a person loves you doesn't mean that their love equates to what you know as love, you know, and that's part of the getting to know you or getting to know that person process. You know, people speak love in different languages and they express it in different languages. It doesn't mean they don't love you any less than what they deem to be love, you know, and as far as forgiveness, forgiveness is a process like healing. It doesn't happen overnight. It doesn't happen because you want it to. It's a choice that you're making to allow it to happen in your life as it should. So, yeah, this has been one of the most really inspiring and encouraging episodes I have done to present day. What would you say about that, Jasmine?
Oh, yeah, this definitely had a lot of perspective in it. And I thank you so much, Bailey, for coming on the show, giving us your input, because I think it is interesting to get different perspectives, because sometimes I think we choose to, even as women, you know, just focus on what, you know, what women my age are going through, you know, versus like all of us are kind of going through the same thing still, mm-hmm. just at different points in life, which so maybe true. If we knew the game sooner, we could play it better.
Oh, can you repeat that?
If we knew the game sooner, we could play it better.
Did you hear that, Bailey? Yes or no?
Yes, I heard it.
So, I want to extend the invitation to bring you back. We will talk about that more off the air, but we have thoroughly enjoyed this this particular segment of Breaking Up is So Hard to Do. And I think we have provided our audience with, like you said, Jasmine, some insights, as well as Bailey kind of detailed her process as to what she did to transition and unravel from her relationships. And we listed she grieved. She gave herself permission to grieve. She gave herself space. She demanded her space. She knew that she had to figure things out. That's an important key. You have to figure things out. You can't just be aimlessly roaming around in the world, right? And then she avoided him and any triggers that came with that. So, wonderful. Bravo. Bravo, Bailey. So with that being said, we are going to wrap up this particular episode of Diva Speaks. I want to thank everyone who made this podcast or this episode on the podcast happen today. For those of you who are listening, Jasmine, what are we asking them to do? What are we going to put our foot down and ask them to do?
Look, if you are feeling your girls, okay? If you're feeling us.
Feeling us.
If you're feeling us.
Feeling us.
What we need you to do
is
keep streaming.
Stream it.
We've got other episodes for you to listen to. We want you also to share.
Share it.
Send it to your friends.
Be generous.
Right, your parents. I'm just saying, you never know.
Paw now.
Everybody got relationship problems, okay? It's not limited.
Oh, your nana can listen to it too. Hint, hint, wink, wink, Bailey.
And we want you to subscribe. Let us know that you're feeling us, and we'll make sure that you're getting soon to come exclusive content.
Amen. And the website is divaspeaks.podbeam.com, and you can send us an email to divaspeaksofficial@gmail.com. If we have stepped on anybody's toes, number one, we don't apologize, but we do ask that you step up and speak out, so that the conversation can continue. Until next time, the diva has spoken.